spirituality and technology, a field I really like, because I come from the world of computers and digital media, and I got interested in spirituality, and I think they match quite nice. Colette Kavanagh is a film producer who is now studying the other things like spirituality, and is in the Netherlands to research the subject of spirituality and technology. Colette, what brings you to look into this?
Well, it's a subject that interests me very much because technology is so much part of our modern world, and I'm interested in what place it can play in the spiritual evolution on the planet.
Mm-hmm. That's quite a wide thing. I mean, you could look at spirituality and technology from the point of a tool for yourself, like if it could help you, but to look at this, if it would help the planet, is quite a far-fetched idea.
Well, I think there's a lot of talk nowadays about the destructive possibilities of technology, but I think there's not enough focusing on how it can be used in a positive way.
Well, this fear about, you know, the world going to pieces because of not only nuclear bombs but also the ozone layer and stuff like that. I always like to point at times, say in the Middle Ages, when the Black Plague came around, I think a third or half of the people of some areas was wiped out. Those were disasters that are really incomparable to what we experience now. We have natural disasters and you know, ecological problems, but those days were also very serious. So I don't think that's new, that this idea that technology will wipe us out, you know, whether it's technology or Genghis Khan, doesn't really matter. That, I think that's a basic fear in people about their future, about what's happening. Now we see technology a little bit as a, from the New Age perspectives, let's put it, technology is a bad thing because it has destroyed natural life and the farming, and in the Industrial Revolution has driven out, you know, agriculture, stuff like that. I don't know, I think it's another tool, like mankind has developed tools since, well, I think the apes use little tools themselves, and we started using tools and all kinds of tools. We have developed processes. I mean, is there really a difference between using a brain machine or doing yoga, in the sense that both are tools? Both are systems developed with it. It's both are technology, in fact. Mm-hmm. The systemized approach of yoga, where you do exercises and stuff in a specific order, is not much different from what, say, a doctor does. He, when he operates on you, who does it also in, you know, in a specific order, he knows what to do, where it will lead to, what the effect will be. So technology is not new. Technology is, in fact, very old. As soon as we took up tools and thought about systems and processes to do something, that has been around. Only these days we think that the computer and the separation that technology brings, because that's what the thing people feel. It brings separation. You don't talk to people anymore, you watch television. We don't play games, we switch on.
By separation you mean isolation? Isolation,
no,
or separation?
No, separation is, well, in the Middle Ages the word was thou art that, which means thou art that is what is inside and outside, as above is below and stuff like that. I actually believe that Shakespeare said, to be or not to be that is the question. Which meaning, thou art that. Are you that what you see, or are you not? Mm-hmm. Of course, all the mystics in the world have always said, thou art that, you and the world. And that basically you separate by first naming it and then judging on it. Any judgment on anything exterior separates you from it. And even in the Bible you can read that the angels were not given the right to name things. It was Adam who had to name things. So that indicates that the first step in separation between us and that outer world that is really a reflection of the inner world is separation. Separation by thinking, by judging, and now we separate by technology. We have a whole set of tools that separate us from touching the other person, but also really communicating. We learn to cope with it. A very good example is the telephone. In the 30s and 40s, I remember, you know, I wasn't there, but I have seen television programs where you see people picking up the telephone and they would phone to people, say, in Indonesia. A mother to her son who was in the war, and she would really shout. She would say, "Hello, Bandung, are you there? Are you there?" As if she could reach out. Yeah. Technically, we have 3 kilohertz of bandwidth. You know, a very limited bandwidth to play with in a telephone. But now we have learned within that bandwidth to do a lot of things. We can shout at people, make love over the phone. We can do all those things. You know, we have learned to cope with. But in fact, it is. We really have limited ourselves. We have pushed our communication into a very narrow channel. Whether it's good or not, I don't know. We can just observe that we look at the television, which is a very small screen, in fact, yeah? Mm-hmm. And it also has a limited bandwidth in colors. Mm. You know, you can't see many colors on a television. Limited pixels. And yet, we cry in front of the television. We do all these things. A computer is even worse. Not only because it's, you know, it's also a screen, but because it's a very specific representation of data. We look at it and you know, sorry to say, but it started with Apple. And I always said Apple had a hypnotic interface. But the next thing is that now we're into Windows. And Windows is the way Bill Gates looks at information or at data. Let's make a distinction between data and information. And he forces us to look at the world with his eyes. I mean, there is no housewives interface. There is no therapeutic interface with the computer. You know, what you have is Windows. You look at specific fonts, you know, letters, types, stuff like that. Really, a very limited approach. I think that is something we should look into as a society. That the monopoly that's building up in the computer world by some software companies that force us to look in a very limited way to the whole world. Mm. And now we have this with the internet. Everybody believes that the internet is the way to get information. Well, let's make this clear first. Data and information are different. Very different. Data is what's out there, and it only becomes information if it changes you. That's the formal definition. Information, in the communication science, it's you know, it's the definition of information. It's only if it changes something at the side of the receiver, it's information. Otherwise, it's noise. It's data. It's something out there. So I say a bit is only information if it bites. Which, yeah.
But don't you... I mean, there's no shortage of information these days. And the internet is...
There's no shortage of information.
Data. Yes. But isn't
there enormous...
Information
is what changes you. And that is rather limited.
Don't you think what we really need is wisdom? And that is very different than information.
Yes, but then you get into things like what the brain researchers look into. First we start with data, and then, you know, stuff that's out there, and it becomes maybe information because it gets into our brain. But then you get a whole hierarchy. First you get whether it fits in, if we can name it. Then it gets a thing like memes. You've heard this word. Memes are, I think Dawkins coined the phrase, are mental images where it fits in. But between the memes and the neurons, what's actually happening, we're not sure what happens. We can make pictures. Carl Priebaum and Francesco Varela and those guys have done a lot of research, and they put all kinds of stuff on your head, magnetic and electric and whatever, and they can see what kind of happens chemically and electronically, electrically in your brain at the moment, or magnetically at the moment, that you think about something. And they do tests, they show pictures to people. Now, this gives us an outside look at we think that we know what's happening, but in fact we don't. I mean, it's just more colored picture that tell us that something is happening. But we don't know. We still don't know, for instance, whether things like consciousness reside in the brain or in the whole body or maybe even in the liver, stuff like that. I mean, we are fairly insecure about it. People like Rupert Sheldrake and others who believe that there is some kind of field, whether you call it morphogenetic field or ether or whatever, around us, they say, well, maybe, you know, the body is more than this, and this is a scientific approach. But the old Hindu religion, of course, knew it. They called chakras and auras, and they had it about all these kind of bodies that we have. So technology is really just catching up. It's like going back to the roots. What we knew before intuitively, we're now finding out.
But is it going back to the roots? Because in a sense, for example, so many of us these days look at television and we look at war and death and things like that on television. And then we can just switch over to another channel. So really, it's separating us from truly experiencing what's happening.
That's what I started with. Separation is the thing.
Separation.
We have to look into technology in how far it separates us from the true experience and in how it forces us to make a judgment. You know, if you make a television program, you have made films yourself. Now you can make a film that doesn't force you to think this is the good guy and this is the bad guy. Of course, it's very easy for television to make good guys and bad guys. Huh?
Yeah.
And we like that. We say it's a good program because you really feel this. But in fact, it's training us. It's hypnotizing us. It's NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, will tell you how that all works. But it's training us to believe there's good guys and bad guys.
Yeah.
Because and the more we believe that, the more there are good guys and
bad guys. Yeah? Exactly.
This is the thing. If we start treating people as numbers, as digital data in a computer somewhere, if a policeman never looks at your face anymore but just types in your name and looks what comes on data, we become inhuman. If you treat people like numbers, they act like numbers. And they're going to react like numbers and without human qualities.
Mm.
So this separation that technology brings is the real problem.
Mm-hmm.
But then the hopeful thing is that technology at the same time brings a new understanding. Now let's go back a few centuries where, you know, with the Cartesian thinking and cogito ergo sum, all that stuff, we became so-called rationalists. We did away with belief systems. We said if we can't see it, if we can't measure it, it doesn't exist. Interesting. When you read in the school books about enlightenment in those days, it means transfer to rationalist things. You know, do away with belief and paganism and all that kind of stuff. Out of the door, the new time is here. If we, you know, measure it, make formulas, do stuff like that. In fact, that wasn't enlightenment. And if you read people like Kant and those guys, Kritik zum reinen Vernunft. For me, it's very clear that those guys came from a very deep belief system, and they were trying to separate what they knew from what they didn't know. We think, oh, they were only kind of separating the reality out. No. They said, we know there's God and we believe in this stuff, but let's now try to see what the other side is. But we took only the other side and made that our sole inspiration.
Mm.
Luckily, technology now, 200 years later, gives us means to go back, like I was explaining, the brain measurements, EEGs and all kinds of stuff. They give us indication that indeed the whole thing expands a little bit out of the brain, and that so we come back to understanding that the Hindus wrote down in the Vedas and whatever 2,500-4,000 years ago. So we come back, we come full circle, and now it seems there is a time that we're beginning to accept that we don't know everything, that there's more than can be measured. Doesn't mean technology is exhausted. Definitely not. I recently a friend of mine got cancer, colon cancer, which is like a very quick way to go, you know. And for some reason, in fact, because Tim Leary was a friend of mine and I got interested in the subject of cancer, I got a Rife machine, Royal Rife, who in the 30s developed the machine. And I got that machine, I sent it to Tim, he never used it, I got it back. So this friend came here and I said, you know, come here for a month and we'll see what it does. So far, this is a month later, the x-rays are better, stuff like that. This stuff seems to work. I don't make no medical claims, it might be any other reason, but it seems that there's something there. We hear of people using Tesla coils for all kinds of stuff. There is a group in Italy, the Damanhur commune, who has a very interesting subterranean temple. But what they really do is they research time travel, both what we know as astral of out-of-body experience and factual time travel, where the body goes another time. And people come back and have strange experiences and stuff like that. That's also technology. It's not mainstream technology, but those things are there. Rupert Sheldrake, a guy who said, hey, let's look into what we do with animals. What happens if I look at someone? Normal physics. I was trained as a physicist. I mean, hey, if I look at you, the light comes from the sun, falls in your face, and I, you know, it's not like me doing something to you. Rupert Sheldrake says, let's see if you look at someone's back, if he feels it, which is against the laws of nature as we know it. So he's researching an expansion of our technology. So technology isn't dead, and there's many ways to go. And the differentiation between, say, accepted technology and unaccepted technology is just that one university or another has to say, hey, this is legitimate.
What way would you like to see technology going? What's your dream for technology?
That we use it to research this separation processes. Why do we separate and how do we separate? What happens if I look at that guy and I think, you know, I don't like him? Yeah. By now, we know that something happens. That I radiate something, he feels lousy, I feel lousy, it's not a good way to go. It would be a little bit stupid to make a little bleep that says, hey, you have a negative thought and don't do it. You know, that's ultimately what could happen. Just pick up the brain waves, translate him and say, hey, this is a bad thought, don't do it. With the thought police idea, you know. Once we can do that, we can do many, many strange things. But take it on a simpler level, to teach people that what the effect is of their thoughts would be an interesting thing. It would help people individually to grow. And this is the old thing, where we started again, is technology something that is going to help the whole world, the whole consciousness of the world, you know, go up? Or is it a thing that individual people do? Now here we have to see that the individual is always the small cycle in the big cycle.
Sure.
That if the whole world feels something about, you know, the coming of Christ or the Aquarius thing, then the individual will feel that too. There's a small and the big. Mm. Individuals will sometimes feel that they influence the big cycle, that what they do, like sometimes you feel, oh, this is happening, I have to do a specific thing to make it happen or whatever. But maybe it's the other way around, that you just pick up in advance the main wave and then you do your little thing. We don't know. Time, some people say, is an illusion. And if you believe in time travel, and physicists these days, theoretical physicists say that it should be possible. And I know some people in California are actually trying to find ways to shoot like one bit in 24 hours in the future by computers and probabilistic and stochastic processes. So it seems that technology, non-locality principles in physics give an indication that those securities, so those truths in physics, like you can go faster than the speed of light, stuff like that, relativistic Einstein stuff, might not be true. In fact, what we're learning is in physics is that object and observer, observed and observer, are related by some kind of awareness, some kind of consciousness process. Mm. Without it, we couldn't explain what we see normally, mm-hmm. what happens in physics. So again, we come back to what the Vedas already tell us, that they must have known much more than we did. Whether they did it based on the same experiments or just had this feeling, I don't know, but they understood a lot. So where do I want it to go? Well, I don't want anything. It's fine. The sun shines. Actually, you know, it's enlightenment is opening your eyes in the morning and feeling the sun. I don't know. I have no. A long time ago, I thought that you know, we need to do things, and a good example is, God, we have to protect the whales. You know, was California really a good thing? Protect the whales. Because of that, a surge in, you know, films and movies and photographs about all these animals came up, and people started photographing whales. Now, in those days, you needed the whales very clearly because they had a certain kind of stuff that you need to make pictures shining. So the more we looked at the whales, the more pictures were made, the more whales need to be killed. You see, that's one of those things where then the Tao says, you know, what you do, you have to undo.
Yeah.
So I don't want anything because that would mean I have a vision of where we're going. I can only say every day I have a choice for things to do and not. And it seems that I'm involved in technology and computers and brain machines and rife machines and really all kinds of technology, drugs, psychotherapeutic use of psychedelics, things like ayahuasca. All those things come up in my life, and you know, if someone comes to me and say, we are going to do an ayahuasca experiment, can we use your place? Yeah, why not? You know, it's not totally legal, but we're in Amsterdam, so it's okay. It's a kind of research. If a person says, hey, we can use this and this kind of machine to see if we can cure cancer or this or that, why not? If a person comes and, you know, what can I say? What can I do? I can only use it. In the end, maybe later said, hey, I helped develop a scientific nuclear bomb again. You know, there are indications that, for instance, the knowledge of sound. And sound, for many, many uses, is very important. That. Yeah.
And what about color? Isn't there a possibility that in the future, when somebody goes to hospital, that instead of operating on them surgically, we will treat them by beaming color on them and healing them with color?
Well, you know, the color healing is fairly well developed in the sense that we know what colors do.
Mm.
You have to see that we only see a very narrow spectrum. We see one octave, while in sound we can see 20 octaves, or we can hear 20 octaves. So your sound is a little bit more broader than in the beginning. There was energy, and we think it was sound, because that really what we see is very limited. That doesn't mean that we should not talk about the total spectrum of electromagnetic energy. And that's where, for instance, this Rife machine comes with a certain spectrum. You see, there is no real fundamental difference between radiation therapy with, say, radium or whatever radioactive materials you have, or something else in the electromagnetic spectrum. Röntgen. Light, ultraviolet, sunlight, whatever. We know a little bit about sunlight, how healthy it is at times, but we're talking about on the, you know, technically on a very limited part of this whole spectrum. I'm sure that we will find out that we have, that the real pollution, well, I have two examples about pollution that we don't see. This one is you know, what's around us, radio, television, it all, we are bombarded, really. The other one is that, just give you a different kind of perspective, we're in Amsterdam now. Suppose you were some creature living under the earth, and you're just the other way around, like you live under the earth, and you would, you know, you happily delving your way, and then you came in the neighborhood of Amsterdam, which is built on very long poles, 20, 30 meters, you know, 30 yards. Man, you would think that is horizon pollution, really there, you know, from under the earth. This is really horrible. We have put poles in there. Now, some people say that the earth is very sensitive to this kind of stuff. And if you make holes or put poles in it, it's as bad as making, well, I don't know, you know, we believe that the Celts and maybe older people built Stonehenge in those places because they were acupuncturing the earth. So now we put all these poles in. Man, maybe in 100 years we will say all this horrible pollution of Gaia and so on. Get those suckers out of there. Well, that's a job, I tell you. This whole country is built on those poles, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
just a way of looking at things. Yeah. Another thing, of course, what we know now is radiation, light is only part of it, influences us. So I would really advise people, build your houses a different way. And then there comes this stupid thing again. Remember that we for a while said lead-based paints are really bad, you know. Bah, kids lick on it, you die and stuff. Mm. Yes, but lead-based paint are very good to keep out radiation. So if you would have lived in a wooden house with lead-based paint, maybe... So we just took the whole stuff out and now we have to bring it in again. But I would advise people really to think about building houses that are like Faraday cages that are shielded from. I sleep in a bed where I really put aluminium foil around and copper thread. Because I think one of the examples there is, for instance, a crown. Mm-hmm. A crown, a golden crown. Yeah. One time I was in this Damenhoer commune and I was in a deep under the earth in a gold plated room. And it was incredible. It was like I was feeling there, all disturbance from the outside world was gone, even from the planet, and I only felt myself like, wow. Later I thought, you know, this is interesting. So I asked people who work in gold mines, stuff like that. And then I thought, wait a moment. Now, we have always given kings crowns with gold. What happens if you give people a crown and then do all this research with brain and so on? I asked Carl Priebe, he said, it's an interesting idea. But he didn't really see it. But I think it's important that we understand that those things help in a specific way. Mm-hmm. It keeps away the radiation. So maybe we should all have crowns now.
Or maybe we should leave the gold in the earth.
Maybe well, that's not to say, because that comes out. You have to understand that even in the old days, gold sometimes comes to the surface in nuggets and stuff like that. So it has been used, and it has magical qualities. We don't know what it really does, you know, electrically, magnetically, whatever. We only know that for some reason they always gave the top dogs the kings and the golden crowns. Mm. So that, well, I know. But a funny thing, technology we've never thought about. Mm. We did, for instance, we know that hair shields us from the radiation of other people. We know this, and in England still, like a judge in a court, he has to have hair all around him. He has a wig. Mm. Why? They say it's tradition. But maybe the basis of the tradition is that it makes him less vulnerable to all those guys in the court there. Mm-hmm. These days, there's a tendency for police people to, or, you know, it's kind of whatever, people to shave their heads. Mm. You know, that really makes a different feeling. If I were a police chief, I would forbid that. Mm-hmm. They need caps and they need hair, because otherwise their aggression goes out and they're too vulnerable for the aggression from other people, so you get this stuff. Now, do people take me serious when I stand up and say, hey, come on, guys, let's think about these things? Other example is, of course, the uniforms of the police. If you have a different uniform, you have a different radiation, you feel different. Well, what we do these days, we call it democracy or whatever, work relationship. These guys can choose their own uniform. You know what we got? We got more and more belts and guns and hanging there and paf, paf, leather jackets. Phew, we really... It makes them more aggressive. Mm-hmm. More separation, more... Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. And we knew that from the fascist times, that more, mm-hmm. yeah, mm-hmm. And still we allow the police all over the world to get dressed more. I mean, this is really a trend over the last 15 years. You see, they went from fairly decent looking now to, yeah. Mm. Is this technology? Well, it's technology for me, because I realize there's a basis for it. It's not a technology that people see. Mm-hmm. Does it influence us? Absolutely. When you talk about colors for everything, we are very hypnotizable beings. You know, we get used to colors, and you know, it's everything. Mm. Fashion, lipstick, I'm just you know, those colors change that, and you change your awareness.
I saw an interview on Dutch television here last week with somebody who went to fight in World War I, and the reason he signed up was he was attracted to the uniform. He didn't know anything. He said he didn't even know what the word democracy meant. But the reason he signed up was he was attracted to the uniform. And that made me wonder how many people sign up because
for the wrong reason. Oh, yes. Well, Aldous Huxley, of course, in Doors of Perception, gives a great description of that. He took drugs and then he described. And he realized that he saw those vivid colors. And he said, now, go back in the Middle Ages, where there were no vivid colors. You know, where there was green and whatever is in nature, but there were these colors, these chemical dyes we make, were unheard of. Maybe in the court and maybe on uniforms. But normal people had no artificial dyes. They had earth colors and, you know, whatever. Mm. Maybe a few things that were around in that neighborhood, you know, red earth or whatever. But then they would go to church and they see diamonds, which reflect colors naturally. And they would see gold. And they would go to see in a court or in a, you know, to see the king or whatever. These people were the only ones that were dressed in these fabulous things and had our whole place, you know, the walls were full with colors. And this was like, for those people, that was impressive. You know, they had no music except what they could sing. They would go to church once in a while and then maybe hear an organ or something. Yeah. So and Aldous Huxley described very carefully that this was totally attracting. This was giving power to those people who had the colors and so on. Mm-hmm. So uniform, clearly, you know, just take enough LSD and you see what it means, what a weapon means, the power that goes with what we project in that kind of stuff. Mm. In fact, you can say that we are a far way away from the natural state where we see the world and not, you know, so influenced. I believe that the Bushmen, who we have some notion about what the Bushmen or the Aboriginals are and why they despise of colors and artificial things and anything you have to carry and stuff like that. They want no separation. They don't want to own something. All this, they're not modern because they have been all through the ages, but definitely they have separated us from our spiritual experience.
But going back to this man who went to war because of the uniform, don't you think really what he was attracted to was the sense of power that uniform gave him? And
but that's the oldest trick in the book. Now, I know a little bit of Reich, and I spoke with his students, but I have my own definition of fascism. Fascism is when we allow, or when we adapt, a superiority environment to compensate for our inferiority complexes. And that is my definition of fascism. And that's what Apple did with their computers. And I wrote that and I got a lawsuit with Apple about it and then I hushed it. But that's what I basically believe, that if we allow technology to take this role of a superiority environment. Now, in the world where a uniform was technology, I mean, those colors and the stuff and the steel and whatever, that was technology too in those days. On the other hand, I remember Teilhard de Chardin writing. He was a soldier. He was a priest, but he was a soldier in the First World War. He described it as the most ecstatic time of his life, being out there at Verdun with all these people fighting. He said, you know, there was no rank and order anymore. Everybody was there right now. Paf, you could die any moment. It means you lived now.
Yeah, but there was also probably the true meaning of brotherhood at that time.
Yes, those things we've forgotten. Yeah. You know, there are sentiments among us that maybe fit more in those hunter societies where we could communicate at a distance, telepathy and stuff like that, but we lost because we didn't need it anymore.
Yeah.
Also, there's a theory that says we lost it because we have all this crap out there. We have radiation here and there. When Reich did his experiments with cloudbusters I think he did 53, 55. And recently that technology has been used. But he thought it was extremely powerful. And now it seems to work, but it's not like we use it every day, cloudbusting. And I think that in those days there was less radiation. In fact, things like nuclear explosion, there was a guy who told me that he had his life's experience, so it's like a out-of-body experience, at the moment that he later realized was the atomic bomb in Japan, Hiroshima. These things are very strong. These radiation, electromagnetic forces, whatever is there, and they might actually have forced us to shield ourselves, and by shielding, of course, you shield out also the finer things. One theory of the evolution of awareness, of consciousness, says that, you know, that 40,000 years ago we had nothing. We were just animals who came out of the trees, and then slowly there seems to have a big surge in consciousness around 11,000, 12,000 before Christ, and they said that really pyramids were built then and not 5,000 years ago. But then you see us going up, maybe you notice, but silent reading is only happening since about 11 or 1200. Before that, people were always reading aloud. Mm-hmm. Saint Augustine, who lived, I think, the 4th century in North Africa, was known throughout the Western world as one of the people who could read something without
reading out loud.
And even the old languages, as you know, they don't have the letters, you know, like the Jewish, they have, well, how do you call these, the A and the B, and the A and the E, and the U and the O, they have the...
The vowels?
No? Yes, they don't have that. Uh-huh. They only have the consonant. Mm. So, in those days, you could only repeat a text if you've heard it before. Only after 1300, the notion developed that we could read silently. So we're now... Yeah, it seems some kind of evolution. But is that a defense system against... more stuff, more technology, more stuff we took out of the earth? As you say, taking gold out of the earth, of course, it means bringing out something which might have a radiation at some frequency we don't know, at some field we don't know, that might have polluted us, so we have to defend ourselves against it, and then we have to find all these other awareness tricks, really, silent reading and especially self-consciousness.
Not just gold, also oil. For example, We're taking oil out of the earth and putting it in the sky. And that oil, the function of that oil is to lubricate the panels in the earth. So, I mean, we really have to question the whole technology in that sense too. I mean, where are the boundaries?
Yes, and where are we going? Now, some people believe we're going to have a big bang and something will happen very soon, and people like Terence McKenna have all kind of computer models to prove that we're really progressing and this is time. And on the other hand, the mystics tell us time is an illusion. So why would it happen now? I don't know. As I say, you know, we make decisions every day about our life and everybody else's life, and stuff happens. I'm not afraid for ecological disaster. I think... we did it so we would cure it. And things like the ozone layer, if you all think about it, will change. And this is what people like Reich researched, and we think Tesla did. That we, well, you know, it's very simple. If you look at a little cloud, you look at a cloud, or we both look at a cloud, it sometimes disappears. We know that on special days, like Queen's Day in Amsterdam, it's usually good weather. Mm-hmm. While around it, it might be raining. What is it? Because we just do something there. So... if we can do that, we can do something about the ozone, yeah? And maybe we already did. By becoming aware of it, we already did. So, you see, there is some ground to believe that everything is an illusion.
But then we have to become aware of it in the first place, and that's one of the advantages of technology, that it can spread information.
Yeah, but that's the fallacy of our times, that we believe that if we put more shit on the internet and 60,000... pages, 60 million pages, 60 billion pages, that it means there's information. That isn't information. That is data. That is stuff. Mm. What is out there. And, you know, the first year of the internet, I had the first internet cafe in Amsterdam, and we have, I think, 8,000 pages on the net since October 94. I did everything on the internet, and now they say I'm the black prophet of the internet because I don't believe in it anymore. It doesn't give the average user anything. There's nothing in it for me. Yes, if you're a researcher and you want to know all this stuff, and if you have 12,000 friends in the States and you want to email every day with, great. Well, I am one of these people. I own computer magazines, I make television programs, I have many, many friends in the States, in the spiritual and the technology world. And still, you know, out of my 120, 150 email messages a day, maybe 4 or 5 are from my friends and mean real interaction. The rest is people with crappy questions or come and look at my homepage, stuff like that. Really, everybody who sends me an HTTP URL, as they call it, locator. I hate that kind of mail. I don't want it. It's... that is it's not information, it's noise, and it takes me away from what I really want to do, is have meaningful interaction.
Quality communication.
Yeah.
Quality.
It's an American term, yes. Quality life. I need quality time with you, with my kids. Well, every time is quality time, because if you make the separation between non-quality and non-quality, it means that being not angry, I don't know. That's a qualification I don't like. But it's true that you get a lot of noise from internet. You get a lot of noise from the web. Email is okay, I think, as an alternative to faxes and stuff like that. But not this World Wide Web. Average people, Joe Sixpack, is not going to use the web. Believe me, you know. Why? To find the stats for his baseball games and stuff like that. We feed him that anyway. He's going to addicted to know what the batting average of this and this guy is. But is it important? Is it information? Does it change his life? Mm. Yes, for some of us who have these cards and do something with it. But most people, it's not. Mm. It's a hypnotic rhythm. If it's not there, you say, oh, what a bad thing. You know, then I didn't see the background of the main players. That's what they give you these days. Not only the game, but all this noise behind it. Mm. I don't believe in that. That's why I say the internet will never be a mass medium. It will be a very interesting business medium, maybe 25% of the people. But I foresee that even now it's already going down. I mean, the growth is
at its maximum.
Yeah, well, it will grow a little bit more, but it's not. It's peaking out already. Mm. You can feel it. Now, I said this a year ago, and I said, you're crazy. No, the real question is, what's in it for me?
Where do you think it will evolve to? Do you see any seeds coming out of the internet that may be evolving into something?
Yeah, I have three maxims there. One of them is data is no info. As I say, data is just noise. Information is what changes you. And that goes with my belief that we seek information, that we, in fact, information is that stuff which we invite. And as the old guy said, you'll never learn anything that you don't already know. And you see, the internet proves that. You don't see nothing you don't want to see. You just go and look for the stuff you want to see. It's very self-serving, very narrowing your view. You go and look at the pages, Playboy, whatever, you know, what you want to see, and nothing else. So that's the first thing. Data is no info. Second, local is not global. They call it the global medium. But what do I care about Berkeley University coffee machine to look at, or what the first step on the moon, stuff like that, if I'm not a student researching the subject or a scholar, whatever. I don't care. I believe that the local information is going to be 80-90% of the internet, because you want to know what the pizza joint has for what's a day special, what is happening in the local theater, what your peers think about this specific movie that's playing around the corner. Yeah, that kind of stuff. That's real stuff. So I think it's going to be much more local. And then the last thing, real is not virtual. I mean, we believe in cyberspace now. It's a great concept, and it has always been around, this stuff out there where we project not the physical, but our ideas, this whole world of ideas and concepts and stuff like that. It's always been there, but now we have a name for it, cyberspace. Bill Gibson did that. Thank you, Bill. It's a very nice word and a very nice concept, but it's virtual. And if we serve the web and nothing really happens in our own life, if we don't, based on the net, go do something, write this paper, go out and buy something, whatever, if nothing falls in the door, then nothing happened. Maybe it's like reading books, you know, you get a nice idea once in a while, but it's cyberspace. It's not, it has to be real. You have to go out of the door and you have to feel different. Say, hey, wow, now I go and do something. I change my career, whatever. Now, if you take those three maxims together, I think that points to something, and it points to the other side of digital technology, not the black and white stuff, not the cold data wars that we have. You know, we have replaced the Berlin Wall with what I call the data wall by giving people identity passes and this and that. We scan your iris, we put your picture in all kinds of data banks, whatever. That's the data wall. We keep the riffraff and the poor people out by the same way as we did before with big walls. We only call it an electronic. Oh, we do it for good reason, to protect them, to get them. But we separate. Again, we separate, and by separation, we We make war in the end. But so the good thing is, and then we have to believe that there is a wider consciousness, that the earth, and this is called the Gaia theory or whatever, that the earth in itself has a consciousness. Then we have to believe that that world does something to this, and that on the world is one big transistor. It's all silicium, silicon, and on its surface it has a little bit of other stuff, like a little transistor is really built upon silicium with germanium or whatever on top. A little contamination, you call it contamination, and then it does funny things. A transistor does all kinds of things. It seems like the world is a big chip, and on its surface it's now making a, it's weaving a web of copper threads and information technology and whatever you call it. Hey, that's interesting. Why would it do it? To raise the whole consciousness? That's a nice option. I don't look so far. I look at things that are simple. I say, hey, it seems that we, that the world itself is replacing the lack of communication between people, the lack of closeness, by new means. First we made big media, and now we see the media are getting smaller and smaller. You have 100 channels of television, it becomes uneconomical to really run this crazy system, so we go to local television. So instead of internet, I'm now making local television. I like it, because I think it's the wave of the future, because we are going to go more small. This whole wiring of the planet will lead to more local, small communication. Me and you, my neighbors, whatever, we will talk again. I make local television here, and people pop in, like you, and we can talk. And we can air it, and maybe 5 people watch, and maybe 5,000. I don't really care. But out of those 5 people, one will come again to my place and say, hey, I've heard about you, or whatever. Great. Good feeling, connectedness, whatever. Local democracy, we can change things. We're going to change the system. So there is a grassroots movement. The people from the internet had a feeling that that was it, but it wasn't. Because that became too big and the big companies stepped in. But this little local media thing, and that's one of the things I'm trying to do in the world, is keep this going. Believe, I fought in Amsterdam to keep the local cable system out of the hands of the big industries. I lost, but we got 10% of the bandwidth for local purposes, what they call public access. So I got a little bit out of it. Hence, we make television. But that's where I really see things happening, not in the global things, but in the very small local media. We have to become small and accessible and stuff like that. Good for politics, good for business, no shopping channels worldwide where you buy your gems in America, but let the local guy around the corner do his little ad.
And let people tell their stories.
Yes, and everybody has a wonderful story. If that is what... You don't believe on the television these days, because it all has to be big and great and whatever, but people have incredible stories. You know, I talk to small people, big people, and they all have stories and a life that is full. If you don't believe that, you don't have to talk about spirituality. If you don't see God in the person next to you, what's the purpose? You know, oh yeah, there's something there, great. But... And start with the people, and start with the society. And I think the secret is that you have to break down those separations, break down barriers. If we can break down those prisons, because those are the prisons we made for ourselves, then a new day happened just now.
So we don't have to go to the cinema to see the big stories. We're all around us here, even on this street. There are thousands of wonderful stories, and there's such a wealth right at our doorstep.
And technology can help us to get resensitized. That's the whole thing. If we, local television is just a step towards resensitizing the people to this really amazing place we have here. You know, this earth, but also this city and this place and these chairs and this water, and it's amazing. And we lost our connection with it. So if technology helps there, fine. I'll support any technology that will do that. And I know technology is also always a sword, you know, it has two-sided. It's like time. The sword of time divides between the determinism of the past and the free will in the future. It's an illusion. As time is an illusion, those two concepts are an illusion. And that the world is so big and I'm so small is an illusion too. I'm the center of my world. I mean, whenever I look at my own movies, my own life movies, so to speak, I'm always in the center. Strange, isn't it? Yes, and I speak to people and they say, yeah, well, I'm always in the center of my movie. Yes? So we're all the center of the universe. And we're all a nothingness in the ocean of everything, which makes us, and on one side, humble, and on the other side, very joyous, because there is, well, this is the mystical connection we have between me and there. We're all one. Actually, we have this thing now. We are one to be, and then make the B with like it. Mm-hmm. We are one to be, and the B should be a little B there. Thank you, Colette.
Okay, it was a pleasure talking to you.